Bienvenue, welcome to everyone. All right, I think most of the folks are here now, and we're just going to hopefully invite a few more to join. Welcome to TIS CCDI and Indigenous Works Open House. We're here today to give everybody an opportunity to learn a little bit more about Indigenous Works. As you know, they are one of our newer partners at CCDI, and they have a long history and expertise in Indigenous inclusion in the workplace. And as most of you are our employer partners, we really value the ability to continue to build relationships with you and to provide you with the tools and the resources that will be helpful for you to create a culture of inclusion in your workplace. For those of you who are not employer partners of CCDI, welcome, and we hope that this event is going to be of value to you. So I welcome you in many different languages, and hopefully this session will be of interest to you. So today, what are we going to do? I am going to spend a little bit of time at the front end to provide you with an overview of the Canadian Centre for Diversity and Inclusion and the current employer partner benefits that we have. With me, we also have Pangus Kung, who is the national lead of partner relations. And so he's available to answer any specific questions that you may have with regards to the employer partnerships. And we have other members of CCDI and the partner relations team here with us as well. Then I'm going to pass the floor over to Kelly Lindsay, who is with Indigenous Works, and he will provide quite a bit of an overview for you with an introduction to the Indigenous landscape, why Indigenous inclusion matters, and an overview of the Indigenous Works membership benefits. Then after that, what we would like to do is announce to you what we are hoping to accomplish for those employer partners of CCDI who also join as members of Indigenous Works, because we are hoping to launch a DreamMakers Council with joint benefits for members of both organizations. So we'll introduce this DreamMakers Council to you. And then after that, we'll provide you with an opportunity to ask questions to CCDI, to Indigenous Works, or to both of us. Okay, so that's our agenda for the next hour. The other thing too is if you have any questions, feel free to use the chat box. We will have a moderator to have a look at the chat box and facilitate the conversation. Thank you. Okay, so very quickly about me, I am the executive director of the Canadian Centre for Diversity and Inclusion. My pronouns are she and her. I actually joined originally some 9 years ago as one of the founding employer partners of CCDI when I worked at the City of Calgary. So I've been with the organization really from the inception, pretty much. My background is in diversity and inclusion in the workplace, and I've led that in a couple of organizations prior to joining CCDI. I'm also a board director of the Canadian Race Relations Foundation, and Canada is my third country, English is my third language. With us, we have Kelly Lindsay, and Kelly is the president and CEO of Indigenous Works. His pronouns are he and him. And really, Kelly is a tremendous source of wisdom and knowledge in the diversity space when it comes to Indigenous inclusion. He's led Indigenous Works since 1998. It's an award-winning organization that has really focused on designing and developing new workplace systems and consulting models. And Indigenous Works launched a number of innovative firsts, including the first job board in Canada for Indigenous talent, the first national Indigenous recruitment fair, the first Mastering Aboriginal Inclusion corporate training program. In 2021, they also launched Canada's first Indigenous Works Employer of Choice certification program. And Kelly is also the founder of 2021 Luminary Advancing Indigenous Innovation for Economic Transformation, Employment, and Well-being. So before we start, I'd like to open the session by honoring the land on which we gather today. And I recognize that there are many people across Turtle Island today, but I am joining you from Calgary. And so I'm joining you from the traditional territories of the Blackfoot, Tsuut'ina, and Yarra Nakoda First Nations. Located where the two rivers meet, this place, Mackenzie's, is now known as the City of Calgary, its Treaty 7 territory, and also the home of the Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3. And Kelly joins us today from Treaty 6 territory and the Métis homeland of Saskatchewan. Okay, so let me start off by telling you a little bit about CCDI, and I will go through this quite quickly. CCDI was founded about 9 years ago by Michael Bach. He is our founder, and he's here with us today. The vision was really to create an opportunity for workplaces to have conversations, to build skills, knowledge, and confidence to address all aspects of diversity and inclusion in the workplace. And it really came out of a need at that time for the creation of a national organization that supports employers in all aspects of diversity, because at that time, such a national organization did not exist. And so CCDI is a made in Canada solution designed to help employers, diversity and inclusion, human rights, equity, and HR practitioners to effectively address the full picture of diversity, equity, and inclusion within the workplace. And we'd like to be thought as a social for impact organization with research and learning woven into our DNA. And we have grown steadily over the past 9 years, and probably we've grown a little bit exponentially as well in the last year and a half. And so we've received quite a few accolades for our work, including being named the Canadian HR Reporter Reader's Choice Award for Diversity Employment Equity Consultant from 2016 to 2021. And of course, we wouldn't be where we are today without the support of our founding partners who stepped up to help us get started in the first place. We actually recently passed a threshold, and now we have over 600 employer partners of CCDI, and the list is growing. So we're very excited, and we thank all of you employer partners for joining us on this journey. Here's a quick overview of the benefits of being an employer partner of CCDI. We organize and host community of practice events. Pre-COVID time, it was in at least 18 cities twice a year. And now we've just been doing this virtually, but essentially twice a year, we get together and we pick one topic, one theme, and then we do deep dive conversations around that topic. We also, throughout the year, organize live and interactive educational webinars, speaker panels, fireside chats, and roundtable conversations on various diversity and inclusion topics. Employer partners of CCDI have access to our knowledge repository, which is Canada's largest e-library on diversity and inclusion. And we're always updating this knowledge repository. And particularly in the last 6 months or so, we've been putting a lot of efforts in adding more French content as well to the knowledge repository. On our website, you can have also access to a number of free reports, podcasts, resource guides, blogs, and toolkits to help you on your journey and provide you with some food for thoughts, access to thought leaders, as well as some hopefully concrete examples or tips of what you can do to create a more diverse and inclusive workplace. Employer partners have access to our CCDI multicultural calendar, and we're just putting the final touches on the 2022 calendar, which will be being sent to employer partners soon. And of course, employer partners have access to our partner relations team. And it's a very hardworking team that tries to be in touch on a regular basis with all of our employer partners to listen to your needs and see how we can best support you on your journey. So in a nutshell, that's the CCDI, and those are employer partner benefits. Now, without further ado, I would like to again introduce you to Kelly Lindsay from Indigenous Works. Over to you, Kelly.
Thank you very much. How's the audio, Anne-Marie? Thumbs up?
Yeah, you sound great.
Great. Welcome, everybody. Great to join you. As Anne-Marie said, I'm speaking from Treaty 6 in the Métis homeland of Saskatchewan in very snowy Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. We had our first winter storm yesterday. So there's about 4 or 5 inches on the ground and winter is here. As you were saying, I'm a Cree, Métis, French on my mother's side, Polish and Ukrainian on my father's. So we joke that we like bannock and pierogies together. I've been a lucky Canadian Indigenous guy who's been able to work in every province and territory, one foot in the corporate world, one in the Indigenous world, and one in the academic world. Before we get going into this, I think all of us, our hearts are heavy, and we're all thinking about our brothers and sisters in Hope, Abbotsford, Agassiz, all the communities that are being flooded right now in BC. Very, very tragic. So our hearts are with them, and that's why they're not here on this open house. I'm going to tell you about Indigenous Works. I'm going to take you a bit of a journey. I'm actually even going to do a bit of Indigenous 101, but this journey starts with Michael and I. This is before he started CCDI. I think, Michael, we've known each other over probably around 20 years. We formed Indigenous Works in 1998. Came out of the Royal Commission as one of the 430 recommendations. But over the years, we got to know each other. And after we were founded, Michael and I met and we talked about our work. We have been, of course, developing expertise in workplace systems, models, diagnostic tools. We have done training and consulting with employers, both in the public, private sectors. And we've conducted some leading edge research, developed a lot of resources and tools, created a lot of public-private partnerships. In 2015, we launched a charity called Kachita, which is a charity, an Indigenous charity focused exclusively on how to increase the human resource and career potential of Indigenous youth, including youth with disabilities. And lastly, Luminary is a new initiative about advancing Indigenous innovation. And we want to link this innovation agenda to commercial impact. How can we create more economic transformation, jobs, and well-being? So sort of the precursor to this is, Michael and I, we worked together, we got to know each other. We basically said, how could the members belong to both Indigenous Works and to CCDI to further their D&I initiatives? And so, Michael, in some ways, our partnership, this marriage of sorts, has been in the works a long time, and we're just thrilled to formally announce this and be moving forward. So let's look at the next slide, please. Or do I have control? Let's see. There. So I want to just talk about you and how are you navigating the Indigenous component of your D&I or your diversity, equity, and inclusion strategies. Generally, what we find is that many employers who do have a D&I strategy, they're either they haven't started or they're stuck on the Indigenous component. It's often the last one that they tackle for a whole bunch of reasons. But the point is, the discovery of those grave sites has stimulated a lot more interest in this whole issue of Indigenous inclusion and exclusion. But at the end of the day, we need to go from these alarming stories and the truth to look at some very concrete things. We know that if you increase the knowledge capital of companies, improve your engagement readiness, we can help do that, accelerate your strategy development, improve your partnership acumen, and embrace things like the Truth and Reconciliation calls to action, these very deliberate, purposeful services help you become experts in Indigenous inclusion. So that's the work we do. It's about knowledge capital. It's about strategies. It's about how to make sense of this for your company and your organization and how to really prepare you to be engagement ready to mobilize new strategies and practices. But who are we talking about? Let's look at the first slide about increasing your own Indigenous capital knowledge. How many Indigenous people are there in Canada? 1.5 million, 4.9%. Who are they called? The First Nations Métis Inuit. There is a baby boom, 42% growth in the last 10 years. So just like there's an aging baby boomer, there is an Indigenous baby boom. The average age of Indigenous people is 32 compared to 42. This is generally the same in the United States, New Zealand, Australia. The gross domestic product of Indigenous people is $32 billion, growing by another $10 billion over the next decade. This is a fast upward mobile workforce, Entrepreneurism is growing 6 to 8 times faster. We are building schools, economies. We're building institutions. We're building social, political, and economic capital. And so there's the real business case for employers to say, how do we join and partner with Indigenous people and communities and companies? And really, it's an exciting time ahead, I think, with the trajectory of Indigenous people well on their way to achieving what Caroline Hilton calls the $100 billion economy. How do we grow opportunities to create and grow this $100 billion economy? But let's take you back. I want how and where, in terms of Indigenous 101, the issue that we find with knowledge capital is that this is what we did not learn in school. We did not learn about Indigenous contributions to Canada. We did not learn about Indigenous people. You might have learned about the fur trade. You might have learned about Pauline Johnson and that great poem, but really not a lot of deep knowledge. Indigenous people, pre-contact, this is how they, their worldview. And often you'll hear Indigenous people, even elders today, they'll talk about Turtle Island. And they see North America as a turtle. And this was first observed in space. When Armstrong was up in space, he said he could see what Indigenous people mean, that the head is up here, the appendages, and then the tail down below in South America. So it does resemble a turtle. And this is what many Indigenous people refer to all this landmass as Turtle Island. And of course, everyone had their territories, regions. There was rich diversity, over 500 languages and linguistic groups, rich social, political, economic nations and people. Let's go to the next slide. The development, if you fast forward though to Canada, when was Canada formed, folks? 1867, BNA Act. But Canada's vision was not one of inclusion, it was one of exclusion. Now you're hearing a lot about the gravesides, but you have to put it in context. In addition, we created the Indian Act, one of the oldest pieces of legislation. It was created 9 years after Canada was formed. So 1867, 76, we formed the Indian Act. Controls every aspect of Indian life. We created social exclusion where women, matriarchal systems were disrupted. Ceremonies went underground. You could not form political parties. You could not hire a lawyer to take land claims to court, et cetera, et cetera. So the education exclusion is one part of this exclusionary policy, which was to take, of course, the children. And the policy of the day for 40 years with Duncan Scott was to kill the Indian in the child. And you've heard a lot about that. And that is why, if you look at it this in context, you take any group of society and you create this social, economic, political exclusion, isolate them, separate them from their children, can't start certain businesses or hire a lawyer, you're going to end up with very dismal communities that look like this. The next slide shows what many communities look like today. This could be Attawapiskat or Lalash, Saskatchewan, where we've got dismal communities with, you hear the horror stories, the black mold, no safe drinking water, water boil alerts that are 10 years old, suicide capitals of the world, 3 of them are in Canada and Indigenous communities and so on. So the real challenge for all of us is to grow the path of inclusion. How do we grow healthy economies, a healthy workforce, and healthy people and communities? That's our collective goal. And we're making progress towards that. But in order to make that progress, we need to really look at where's the level of engagement with corporate Canada today. I want to tell you on the next slide, this image of a research study. You can download it from our website, but it was a study of 511 large and medium-sized companies. We basically assessed them and said, what's your level of Indigenous engagement relations, partnerships, and so on? And there was 5 parts to this questionnaire. It was all done through phone interviews, and they were given points or scores out of 5 areas. So potentially you could score 100 points. Take a guess. Based on these scores, what do you think the average engagement score is amongst 511 large and medium-sized companies? Would you guess an A, a B, a C, a D, F, F minus. Here's the results on the next slide. The average engagement score was 13% or 13 out of 100. 85% of those companies surveyed had no engagement strategies, and only 1 in 4 recognized the Truth and Reconciliation corporate calls to action, 1 in 4. Even though people like Gord Downie had done such great work from the Tragically Hip to raise the awareness of residential schools, still the level of awareness around TRC was very low. Now, who scored the highest? The resource sector. If you look at the resource sector generally, you find many companies who have been doing Indigenous engagement for 20, 30, 40 years. Started in the 80s and 90s with court decisions. They were hit over the head. They had to do this. Today, they're doing it because it makes good business and social sense. They have deep HR strategies. They're working with Indigenous businesses. They have deep community relationships and are directing CSR dollars towards Indigenous economic priorities. They know how to tell their narrative. They've got a good marketing and communication strategy and their leadership. They've got people right through the work floor and the shop floor to the boardroom. And the C-suite of many of these resource companies, they are comfortable and have built their competencies to manage in the Indigenous domain. They are Indigenous inclusion experts. So this is really the state. And the question is, how do we then move you as employers towards Indigenous inclusion strategies? We've developed a number of systems, but the heart is this one. The next slide is the inclusion continuum. This is a 7-stage roadmap to becoming an employer and partner of choice. It has 7 stages: indifference, intimidation, image. Indifference, inclusion is not on the radar. Intimidation, inclusion is seen as forced compliance. What's the minimum we need to do to avoid an employment equity audit or a lawsuit? And inclusion as image is public relations, where, you know, I've seen boardrooms with lots of Native art, but no Aboriginal people working there, or they buy corporate tables, but the tables are empty that night at these Indigenous events. The real business case is stage 4, initiation, where inclusion is seen as a business imperative. From there, incubation, it grows as a core competency. You're developing specific competency areas, you're developing strategies and practices, and you start to incubate this across 5 areas, and you integrate it across skills, HR, procurement, CSR. Those are the big 3, but you also involve marketing, communications, and leadership. Those are the 5 areas of every enterprise, and the most successful companies have integrated their strategies. So inclusion is now a catalyst for growth, and you're able to mobilize and then practice inclusion, stellar inclusion in stage 7. So the next slide just shows you that, you know, for you, you should be asking yourself, where would we be on the inclusion continuum? Let's go to the next slide. So where we often start with companies is a baseline measure. And the baseline measure is a good place to assess where you're at. You get a score, you go through a series of questions with your management team, and you get a baseline report that says, this is where we're at. And when the great thing about a baseline measure, it informs on your future strategies. It starts to set a directional plan of where you should be going in terms of strategies, practices, and initiatives over the next year, 2 years, and 3 years. So it's, again, we find most companies do benchmark around the initiation stage, and they use this as a benchmark and generally measure themselves every few years. The last thing I'll say about this on the next slide is this thing I mentioned about inclusion competencies. I'm not going to go through all these, but you can see that there are 9 competencies that we've identified that every manager and every organization can develop and incorporate into their personal and their organizational strategy. I'll use one example, the very middle one. To see the middle one with an arrowhead, positioning. The question we usually ask is, what do you think your brand is in the Indigenous workforce? Those 1.5 million people, those more than 2,000 communities in Canada, those more than 60,000 Indigenous businesses, what's your brand? How are you attracting and positioning your organization with the Indigenous workforce, the Indigenous community? It's a great question. And it's the precursor. Before you do recruitment, attraction, retention strategies and tactics, you need to be looking at positioning. So it's just one example. As you progress and you get to be masters, we've got a certification program that Anne-Marie announced. So on the next slide, we'll show you the certification program. It's brand new. And we think that the certification program is a way to help benchmark early efforts for rookie companies that are getting started and for more mature companies to reward your performance as you master your Indigenous inclusion efforts. So let me finish off by just talking about the benefits at the Indigenous Works, the Leadership Circle for Indigenous Inclusion. We feel that it's important that you need to increase, I talked about positioning. We know it's important to increase your brand recognition and your visual identity. For many companies, they simply have no brand or they're not known. Indigenous people could not name the types of jobs or opportunities in your companies. We need to change that. We provide leading edge thought leadership webinars and learning programs. We've got specialized resources and tools and tip sheets and other such things. And we also provide summary reports of research activities and initiatives that are underway. We have an annual Inclusion Works gathering event that we've been running for over a decade, and you receive free passes to that. We have a members-only portal that's currently in development, be very similar to CCDI with a members-only portal. And you receive a number of discounts on our consulting services, training both online and in person, our things like our certification program. And if you take a three-year membership, similar to CCDI, who also offers a three-year membership, we provide additional discounts and passes. So lots of benefits, a great way to start your journey. And we're going to look forward to welcoming you. And as Anne-Marie said, the best part is yet to come. If you belong to both CCDI and to Indigenous Works, you're going to be a member of the DreamMakers Council and Summit. Back to you, Anne-Marie.
Thank you so much for that great overview and really providing us with some, I think, valuable context and insight as to, you know, the tremendous potential of Indigenous representation and inclusion in the workplace. I think that's very compelling information. Thanks, Kelly. So going back one step, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission calls for renewed commitment towards reconciliation with Indigenous peoples for the betterment of Canadian society, the economy, and your organization. And certainly in 2019 and again in 2021, CCDI, we've put on two community of practice events to talk about the roles of employers towards truth and reconciliation and the calls to action specific to workplaces and organizations. We've also delivered a number of webinars, and we know that that's really just the beginning of what we can offer. And so truly this partnership between CCDI and Indigenous Works can take us to the next level to address Indigenous engagement, diversity, and inclusion gap. So what does it really mean for CCDI employer partners? Well, when we work together, we can collaborate on content creation and resources, right? Having that expertise with Indigenous Works as our equal partner makes a huge difference in our ability to support you on your inclusion journey. Also, you get additional options for Indigenous advisory, consulting, training, resources above and beyond the partnership. And you can work with our partner relations team who can provide you with further information and answer any questions that you may have on that. And the DreamMakers Summit, right? For organizations that are both CCDI employer partners, as well as active members of Indigenous Works, we want to offer to you a great event once a year where we can all come together and really do a deeper dive conversation, build networks, build relationships, learn from each other, and inspire each other to do this incredibly important work. And so let's talk a little bit more about the DreamMaker Council. What is that? Again, it is for organizations that are members of both CCDI and Indigenous Works. So we'll start off with identifying that it truly would be a very special, unique, and exclusive program, that it would be available to organizations who are both CCDI employee partners, as well as Indigenous Works Leadership Circle members. And some of the benefits that we've identified, and some of you may have received a survey that we sent out a couple of weeks ago to really also gauge your interest. So we've sort of listened to your feedback and we talked among each other and we said, these are some of the things that we believe would be what you'd be looking for as joint members. The first one is the summit, an exclusive online annual forum where we come together and where we talk about Indigenous inclusion in the workplace. Joint members will get 4 complimentary passes and 4 additional passes for the 3-year CCDI and IW members, the ones who commit to a 3-year partnership and membership. And maybe I'll pass over the next bullet to Kelly.
Sure. So folks, one of the things, and I'll tell you why the word dream makers. So these are dream catchers. And I remember when I was in Australia in 2009, they brought us down to help shape their employer strategies in Australia. And there was this Indigenous elder, and I always remember she said, when you stop dreaming, you are lost. And as you know, they go on dream time and their walkabout in Australia. And if you stop dreaming, you're lost. And so in some ways, all of us here, we're in the dream business. We're about helping people aspire to their human resource and career potential. And so one of the things that we've done is you're going to speak with an artist who handcrafts your dream catcher for your organization. The conversation leads to some of the values that you believe in, and it inspires the artist to create your own custom designed dream catcher that you could hang in your foyer, your boardroom, or wherever you choose. And of course, if you want extras, we can arrange that. It'll be a reminder every day about making the DreamMakers Summit into an action agenda. We are going to produce a research report and profile. What we need to do is keep asking ourselves, what's happening in terms of labor market engagement? What's happening in terms of the psychometrics with the Indigenous workforce? What are the current issues that are happening in Canada that will affect your inclusion strategies? These are the types of research reports on engagement, around inclusion, career development, and other such things that will be super valuable to you. And that will be available free of charge, again, to our DreamMaker Summit members. Anne-Marie, over to you about new leadership insights.
Apologies, Kelly. Apparently Anne-Marie's laptop froze while she was talking.
Well, I will be pleased to continue.
You keep going and I will get the deck up in just one second.
So so new leadership insights, you know, I mean, you hear this term, you know, what we need is leadership, but it's true. And leadership is not just the C-suite, it's the operational side. You know, Jacques Fitzens, he wrote this book, The ROI of Human Capital. And the message in his book, The ROI of Human Capital, was people quit their supervisor, not the company. People quit their supervisor, not the company. We know that the most successful companies have designed and implemented their strategy for what we call the middle. Sometimes it's the frozen middle. Senior managers, C-suite, get it. They want to implement Indigenous inclusion strategies. Ground floor, they get it. It's the middle that has the power over budgets, systems, practices, reporting, power. And it's the power of the middle that really we find has made this, has demonstrated where you get real successes in this country. So the new leadership insights, we're going to be listening to you. We're going to be asking you what types of things, where are your pressure points? What kinds of research could we be doing? What are the topics? And we'll be asking and seeking what we call the wisdom of the crowd to inform on our longer research trajectory and agenda together. Let's go to the last slide. So that's really the DreamMakers Summit benefit. Again, For those of you that join both CCDI and IW, you automatically become members. And it's all about making Indigenous inclusion work. And when we do this, we are seeing a fast, upward, mobile group of Indigenous workforce. We have some of the highest registrations in Canada at universities and colleges. In a recent study of universities Canada, 77% of presidents said Indigenous engagement is one of their top priorities. There are at CCAN, which is the Colleges and Institutes Canada, there's almost 100 colleges who are part of an Indigenous consortium. We have over 45 Indigenous colleges across Canada. We have the World Indigenous Nations Higher Education Forum that's connecting us globally. And so we're creating these opportunities to really make Indigenous inclusion work at your workplace, in your sector, and in your industry. So we look forward to this. We hope that we've given you a bit of Indigenous 101 in terms of some knowledge, know-how, really underscore why this is such an imperative for us and you, giving you some insights into an inclusion continuum and how we can help benchmark your efforts and support you with our training and consulting. And of course, the DreamMakers, where we can go together. And in 2022, we look forward to our very first DreamMakers Summit and having you at the table. Anne-Marie, I can see we were able to get you back. Must be some gremlins in the internet. Great to have you back. And let's turn to some questions and answers. I saw one question, which Michael, I'll jump to, is one person asked, how is the certification program different from CCAB's PAR? So folks, there's a certification program by my friends at the Canadian Council for Aboriginal Business called PAR. PAR is Progressive Aboriginal Relations. And that's really the only certification out there like it. Ours is very employer specific. It's on employment and engagement. It's at the PAR program, you get a bronze, silver, gold. Ours system of certification is modeled like the ISO system. We are ISO certified. And we like this idea of creating quality standards. And so ours is more modeled around ISO 9000 standards, where you achieve certain standards in order to be certified in our certification program. We have a great workbook, which is, think of it like your, you know, those yellow book for dummies. Well, think of this as the yellow book to help you on your certification. It's a great guide that helps you because time is our worst enemy. We're also very busy. So we spent over a year testing this guide, helping you create your certification program and process. So it's a pretty time-effective approach. My friends at CCAB, I encourage you to do both. You should check out PAR because it will certify you in certain things. And of course, our certification program around the employer of choice is different, and both are valuable and you should look at both. Other questions that we might have?
Thanks, Kelly. Yes, we have several other questions, and I'm just going to remind people of how they can ask questions. We have the Q&A option. You just click on the Q&A button and you can ask your question directly to the presenters or either anonymously or not. You can also put your question into the chat box. I'm doing my best to monitor that. And we have a couple questions here already. So I'll start with this one. I believe it's for either Emery or Kelly. How can small organizations under 50 employees best contribute to Indigenous inclusion with little to no vacancies and limited financial capital?
Okay. Well, there's a few ways. First of all, we formed a partnership with the Canadian Chamber of Commerce. Mr. Perrin Beattie, the president of the chamber, and I signed a partnership because, as you know, we've got the majority of companies are small businesses. They're under 10, they're under 50, like the question here. The point is this, is that you don't have the time nor the resources to invest like a mining company or a chartered bank in Canada. But there are other ways. You can join consortiums. You can join the local chambers. We have tip sheets and tool sheets that you can implement in your strategies. It's about getting to know the labor market in your region. And if you don't have opportunities today, be looking at opportunities tomorrow. Where are you going? Where are the gaps? Make sure you're working with Indigenous employment centers around training programs for those gaps when they come up. And the other last thing is you might actually develop some strategic alliances with Indigenous businesses and communities that could actually drive up employment for both Indigenous and mainstream folks in your neighborhood.
Yeah, and Kelly, those are all wonderful suggestions. I will just add one more thing is, as employer partners of CCDI, please, you know, take advantage of the webinars that are offered to you. We have quite a number of them in the knowledge repository on Indigenous inclusion or Indigenous related topic. And we're going to have some upcoming ones as well in 2022. If you're an employer partner, that doesn't cost you anything more. And it's a great opportunity to educate your workforce.
Great. I can see the next two questions, Michael.
Yes. So the next question is, CCDI has memberships available for individual practitioners. Does Indigenous Works have a membership for individual practitioners? And if yes, can these individuals still participate in the DreamMaker Summit?
So, and the next question is, what are the costs associated with becoming an Indigenous Works member? So maybe I'll put the two together.
Sure.
So the short answer is no, we do not have currently an individual membership like CCDI, but you're interested in DreamMakers. So reach out to Anne-Marie and myself, we'll talk to you. It's something that maybe we could look at, get to better understand how it works. So currently, no, we don't, but if you are an individual member, do reach out to us because you are showing an interest in the DreamMakers Summit and we'll find a workaround. So to that person, there's that answer. In terms of our membership pricing, we had a membership pricing and we revised it to look like the CCDI membership levels. So we used to base ours on revenue and other such things. Now it's based on employees. We have a national and regional membership, just like CCDI. I think ours, again, we didn't really change our price levels. Our top end was $7,500. I think CCDI is $9,500. But what we did do because of our partnership with CCDI, it did get us to create opportunities for smaller companies. So it's actually a lower cost now for companies with lower numbers, you know, below 5,000, below 1,000 people to join Indigenous Works, to join our leadership circle. So you can get that information on our website and we can also send it out to folks. So I think you'll see it's very reasonable we'll circle back on the individual to see what on the individual membership to see what we might be able to examine and look at.
Great. So there's another question here in the chat. When is the DreamMakers Summit planned for?
Anne-Marie, what were we talking about timing with Pangus? And
we were talking that, you know, because we're looking at creating this DreamMakers Council, so we wanted to make sure, you know, that we would have a critical mass of workplaces joining. And as we're building out of the council and recruiting folks to it, we also wanted to have a little bit of time for us to plan on the research topics. So I think the DreamMakers Summit is going to be one of the events that will be later on in the year. Of 2022 as a result of our efforts to build the momentum and to, you know, look at the research projects as well, both of which, you know, will culminate into more people attending the summit and also having some research findings that we can present at the summit. So we haven't picked a date yet, but I'm going to say it's, but Kelly, if that works for you, probably closer to Q3 or the beginning of Q4.
Prior to that, that would be good timing. And you're right, now I'm recalling with Pangus because we are planning our Inclusion Works National Gathering for June 15th. So we are having our national online event for June 15th. And then in the fall, we would look to host the DreamMakers Summit. So we want to space these out by about 3 months for you folks. So that's sort of the timing that we're looking at. But in the meantime, leading up to that, CCDI has its thought leadership webinars. We have ours. We're also doing some new ones. Like we did land acknowledgement. There has been so much interest for these land acknowledgement training sessions because of the grave sites. We've heard from companies that never really thought about it, but land acknowledgements is one simple, straightforward thing that you can do as part of your reconciliation strategy. And so we've got a training program to actually show you how to do them and why they're important. and get people to stop walking on eggshells. We have to go forward. This is about building friendly relationships. That's what reconciliation is about. Land acknowledgements is just one example of reconciliation in action, and we can help you do that.
Great. So we have another question here. What is the benefit of being both a CCDI employer partner and an Indigenous Works member? Now you've covered some of that, so perhaps you can just articulate the highlights again.
Sure. I mean, I'll start and then I'll pitch to Anne-Marie, but you may be doing, and I hope you are doing well in your D&I strategy, but on the Indigenous component, this is where we bring the strength and the leadership and the expertise. We can help build that component of your D&I strategy and that round you out to be indeed fully inclusive. So this is why it's a good match for CCDI and Indigenous Works to partner. We bring that component to the table, and that's a value to you as members of both organizations.
Thank you. And also Pangus is here as the National Lead for Partner Relations. And so in addition to the slides that we presented, Pangus, if you wanted to share anything as well, you are welcome to do so.
Thanks, Anne-Marie. Yeah, the only thing I would add is that as we're still planning this, please get in touch with your partner relations contacts here at CCDI if you want more information on when the DreamMakers Summit will be, on more information about, you know, Indigenous Works membership or CCDI benefits or anything like that. We're happy to answer any questions after this event as well as we continue planning our programming for next year.
Wonderful. One of the things that we talked as well about, and I don't know if we've given enough context for it in the presentation, is as members of the DreamMakers Council, we don't want you to just attend events and then not have the relationship with you. And so it's really going to be, I think what we're going to strive to do is really build that relationship. And even as we're developing the research agenda, is checking in with you and really trying to listen to what are some of the research needs that you have related to Indigenous inclusion in the workplace so that we can take that information, we can keep in touch, and we're sort of building the research agenda together. We're hoping that it's not going to be sort of a...
Anne-Marie, you froze right there. I'll continue on.
A one-way conversation, but very much council. Go ahead. Can you hear me now?
We can hear you, Anne-Marie.
It broke up, but you know, I think just to underscore where you were going, Anne-Marie, is that look, folks, Canada and Indigenous people, communities, and companies, we're at an interesting nexus point. We've got this baby boom. We have a growing number of Indigenous companies and organizations. And the majority of companies we work with, they say they're nervous. They've been walking on eggshells. They don't know where to start. They, you know, can I do land acknowledgements? I don't want to make mistakes. And we need to move beyond, as I said, this walking on eggshells to be more aggressive and progressive. We need to embrace Indigenous engagement as a strategy, as an opportunity. And this is also for Indigenous people. They're looking to reach out to you. There are companies that want to form partnerships and relationships. Indigenous people are looking to be parts of all kinds of careers. They need to be educated about those opportunities. So it's a journey. It can be a complicated landscape. Indigenous people are diverse. We're like the provinces and territories. Try and get them all in one room and agree on one set of directions or one common national COVID strategy. Complex, very difficult at times. So we need to make sense of it, we need to break it down, and we need to help you mobilize your efforts. And when you do that, you're going to be an employer of choice. And that's really our goal in working, that you're an employer of choice for all people, and that you start to be able to navigate some pretty interesting and amazing outputs and outcomes in Indigenous engagement.
So there was just one other question here. Will only members of Indigenous Works be able to attend the summit? And I believe this person is referencing the DreamMakers Summit.
So just to clarify, on June 15th, we're doing our National Inclusion Works Gathering event. And so our members receive some free passes. Non-members can join for a fee. The DreamMaker Summit, which we are saying would be the fall of 2022, is only open to people who belong both to CCDI and to Indigenous Works. So we want to grow these champions who are committed to both organizations. You're going to have your free passes. You'll be able to purchase additional ones, or if you're a three-year member, you'll be able to get additional passes. But it's an exclusive club in the sense that what we want to do is, it's like the Olympics. We want to take this group and really see how we can listen to you and what your issues are, and also bring some new thought leadership around research, around applied practices, and really move the metrics together on Indigenous inclusion. So again, the Fall Summit, the DreamMaker Summit, be a CCDI member, be an Indigenous Works Leadership Circle member, and you're in the Summit Council.
Great, thanks, Kelly. And seeing as I don't think we have any other questions, I want to thank everyone for joining us today. I also want to thank Anne-Marie and Kelly for sharing this information. We will be sharing a link to both a PDF of the presentation and the recording of this session that you're able to share with your colleagues. And if you have any questions, please do feel free to reach out to CCDI at ccdi.ca or Indigenous Works at indigenousworks.ca. Thanks very much. Have a great day.